Hello and welcome back to See the Pattern. In today's episode, we are going to be exploring Arp's view of the universe, his ideas around cosmology. About 60 years ago, George Abel started to catalogue the distribution of the clusters of galaxies. The cause of these were predominantly old stellar population E-type galaxies, which were believed to be mostly gas-free and inactive. Later, when we developed X-ray surveys and looked at these objects, it turned out that they were far from inactive, and in fact, they were very strong X-ray emitters. Now, in the episode on quasars are not what we think they are, we discussed the fact that Arp became fascinated by quasars. He studied so many that he started to see a pattern. These quasars were always associated with these types of active X-ray emitting galaxies. And the quasars tended to be distributed along and away from the axis of rotation of the galaxy. And if the quasar was further away from the galaxy, the redshift went down. And at the extreme end, so further out that he looked, he no longer saw quasars, but he discovered small prototype and dwarf galaxies. Combining data from the last 32 years of study, the following is Arp's interpretation of the formation of protogalaxies. And it starts with a sequence of quasars emerging from a large active galaxy along its minor axis, that's the axis of rotation. And they start with a high redshift but have low luminosity, and they increase luminosity and decrease in redshift as they move outwards. When they reach a maximum distance of about 500 kiloparsecs, they've started to turn into compact active galaxies. And as they age further into more normal galaxies, they then may fall back towards the parent galaxy. And in that case, they fall back along the same minor axis as they emerge, with little or no angular momentum. The standard model of cosmology suggests that companion galaxies are the remains of collisions with other galaxies, or were simply captured by the host galaxy. Now, if this was the case, then we would expect to find dwarf galaxies evenly distributed around the host galaxies. But this is not what we find, and they've actually known this for quite a long time. Back in 1969, Erik Holmberg had studied many companion galaxies and found that they seemed to be aligned around the axis of rotation. At the time, he concluded that they must have been formed by gas ejection from the nucleus of the host galaxy. Could these all be part of the same mechanism? Could the active galaxy eject this energetic plasma, forming a quasar which eventually evolved into dwarf galaxies? Now, what theory could help explain how the redshift and the velocity of these objects could change, and how could this matter be created in the first place? In order to do this, we have to look at Einstein's theory of general relativity, and specifically we have to look at his field equation, G mu v is equal to t mu v. Now, in this equation, and this is a simplified form of the equation, the t mu v represents the energy and the momentum of a system of particles, and the g mu v represents the geometric properties of the space that these particles occupy. Now, the solution to this equation tells us how the particles will behave over time, and from this we can deduce two things. Either initially, the energy was large and the particles will continue to expand forever, or that the initial energy was small and the particles will eventually collapse under gravity. Now, this caused Einstein much distress, and it forced him to introduce the cosmological constant to just balance the universe, stopping it from collapsing and stopping it from expanding forever. And later, Einstein would actually refer to this cosmological constant as his biggest blunder. In 1922, a Russian mathematician, Alexander Friedman, put forth a solution to Einstein's equations in which the spatial separation of the particle expanded with time. And this is what Hubble pinned his redshift data to, and reluctantly went with the notion that the galaxies were moving away from each other, and therefore space itself must be expanding. And this idea was later then linked to the idea that all matter once must have occupied the same space, and so the notion of the Big Bang was born. And the Big Bang theory assumed that all matter was created simultaneously, approximately 13.8 billion years ago. Now, the problem is that Friedman made an assumption that the mass of the particles doesn't change, and therefore forced the observed effect into the equation, and the solution was that effectively that space itself must be expanding. And this expansion of space-time caused space-time itself to be curved in his equations. In 1977, Narlikar generalized the equations of general relativity, and in his case, he assumed that the mass would change over time. And in fact, he assumed that the mass would change in an equation where mass was equal to at squared, where t is the time and a is a constant. And that means that redshift will now be related to the time, the age of the object, and not how quickly it moves. And in the Narlikar solution, the geometrical terms on the left-hand side of the equation lead to a flat space-time. And as far as we know, that's exactly what we observe. Our universe seems to have a flat space-time and is not curved. The solution that he presented is much simpler to solve and does not require any relativity or tensor calculus at all. Space remains fixed and does not expand, and instead the mass of the particles increases with time, and this means that as the particles are ejected, they gain mass and their movement must therefore decelerate in order to conserve momentum. Now, Sir Fred Hoyle had for a long time been a proponent of the steady state theory, and he worked together with Narlikar to come up with a theory that they called the variable mass theory. And in this, every particle in the universe derives its inertia from the rest of the particles in the universe. And when an electron is just created, before it has time to see any other particles in its vicinity, it will have zero mass. As time goes on, it gains signals from a volume of space expanding at the speed of light, containing more and more particles. Its mass grows in proportion to the number and the strength of the signals it received. And if the mass of an electron jumping from an excited atomic orbit to a lower level is small, then the energy of that photon of light emitted is smaller as well, appearing to be red-shifted. Burbidge then joined Hoyle and Narlikar to evolve the theory called the quasi-steady-state cosmology, and it's effectively an evolution of the steady-state theory in taking into account the variable mass hypothesis. And in this theory, it would allow mini Big Bang events to occur anywhere in the universe, and these events would bring new matter into the universe at those points. And there would be highly energetic events, and if we take into account the variable mass theory, it would allow for these younger objects to have higher intrinsic redshift. Now, interestingly enough, when Arp went to visit Arthur C. Clarke, and Arthur asked him what's new in astronomy, Arp replied, well, there are these extremely high energetic cosmic rays, gamma rays and X-rays coming from the center of our local cluster. And Arthur then replied, yes, waving his hands in the air, matter creation. And this totally stumped Arp. How on earth could Arthur already know about this when he was only just developing these theories? If we look at another galaxy created more recently, then their clocks would appear to be running slower, and their matter, the ones that would emit light, would appear to be redshifted. And as time goes on, the particle mass in that galaxy would exchange signals with more and more matter outside of itself. So the total mass and their clocks would asymptotically approach the same rate as ours. Now, from the standpoint of the cosmic reference frame, the universe is not expanding, but matter is intermittently materializing into it with clocks that run very slowly at first and then evolve to a more normal rate. Now, other implications are that the universe itself is not expanding. It is indefinitely large, and episodically it unfolds itself from many points within itself. And we can only be sure that we are seeing objects within our local supercluster. The distance to the next one may be very large, and hence we may only see a very small part of our universe. Now, the conservation of mass and energy may apply to the whole, but it is not clear that this applies to the part that we communicate with in light photons. So you may question, okay, that's great. Why are we not using this theory? Well, I guess part of the problem lies in Arp himself, the fact that most of the scientific community, it doesn't matter what he used to produce, they just used to ignore it. For me, looking at it, the fact that it simplifies some of Einstein's equations is very attractive. The fact that you can solve the equations in a much simpler form is very attractive. The problem I have with this is that if the mass continues to increase in an infinitely large universe, then as the sphere expands, then as it goes out further and further, then it would almost be like an exponential increase in the mass as time goes on. So there's no end point to that. So what implications does that have for the rest of the universe if mass continues to go upwards? So I struggle with that bit. I can't see a way that's not elegant. Because if mass continues to go up, then there will be parts of the universe that become ever more massive, and you can't keep adding mass, because in its simplest form, mass is energy, if you look at Einstein's equation, and therefore by allowing mass to increase, we are allowing energy to increase. That's not to say that this notion of mass creation isn't something that is worth looking at. Certainly if we look at the idea that these quasars are born out of the galaxies, I find a very attractive solution. The fact that something is happening with these objects that causes the redshift to change is very attractive. Now, mass does explain that in a very simple way, so it is a solution that may work, but for me the problem is that has to be a short-lived event. There has to be something that causes the mass effectively to decrease and then go back to normal, but not to continue to increase. I struggle to see how that would fit into the bigger picture. The problem I have with the quasi steady state cosmology is it almost takes the simple notion of the steady state model and adds a bit of the Big Bang into it. And for me, there are huge problems with the Big Bang, and introducing that into this theory, I'm not sure that it necessarily works. I think, again, the problem with a lot of these things is that there are little gems that need to be extracted. The whole thing for me doesn't work together, but there are certainly notions and ideas that certainly have a lot of merit. And the idea that these galaxies create the matter that we see around us certainly fits also with the paradigm of an electric universe. If there are these vast Birkeland currents coming, flowing across our universe, and that at certain pinch points they start to form matter, which turns into a galaxy nucleus, whatever that is, and I don't believe that it is a black hole with gas flowing in. I think it's more likely it's some sort of version of a star, but on a much grander scale, and that these eject material both in the minor and major axes, which creates the stars that we see and potentially creates the dwarf galaxies. Again, it's interesting that the dwarf galaxies that we observe fit within this pattern, so the fact that they are along that minor axis and we don't find them elsewhere is particularly interesting, because it does imply that there is the notion that they came from that galaxy. So what are my takeaways from this? For me, the most interesting part, I think, is Arp's theory of the creation of these companion galaxies. The fact that these active galactic nuclei eject material which forms into quasars, which then form into protogalaxies, and which then form into dwarf galaxies. This, for me, strikes an accord with what we see elsewhere. This potentially is how galaxies may be formed, that it is not a star first formation, but it is a galaxy first formation. And in fact, it may well be the Birkeland current flowing across the universe, creating these pinch points and drawing the matter in, creating the ball of plasma, which then goes on to populate the galaxy itself. For me as well, the idea of this mass variation, there is credence in this. There is, again, we need to be able to explain if that theory is correct, the ejection of the quasar forming into the galaxy, how the redshift can be changed. And it's certainly one of the ones that would explain why, as the matter is younger, why it would be more redshifted. And there are certainly other examples that he gives, looking at stars and younger stars and younger parts of the galaxy, which also show this intrinsic redshift. But potentially there's another mechanism that, I mean, I don't have the answer, I haven't uncovered it yet, but I certainly think that in terms of the blocks that he's put together, there are some very interesting ideas which we can take away from this and start to fit into our own mesh of the way that we would see the universe working. For now, I hope you found this an interesting insight into Arp and Hoyle and Narlikar's ideas around the alternatives to the Big Bang theory, and hopefully it's given you some insight into trying to understand, from certainly from Arp's point of view, the ideas behind his explanation for these anomalies that he detected over so many years. As always, be brave, be curious, the truth is waiting for us. Until next time.